And the opinions given by the individual host and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of ParaX, its affiliates, or its sponsors.
Step outside of your comfort zone. See the world with a whole new perspective. Join us and experience the unexplained on the Paranormal View.
And welcome, everybody, right here to the Paranormal View on the ParaX Radio Network. I want to thank everybody for taking time to drop by with us tonight on a Saturday night. I know usually a lot of people's busy on the weekends and are out doing things, but I'm glad that you took the time to stop by with us. Chat room's filling up nicely, and want to thank those also listening from around the world. Appreciate each and every one of you. And if you are listening from around the world and you want to come over, feel free to come over to para-x.com, click on the live chat button or chat now button, and you can get in with all these wonderful people, interact with them, and interact with us. If you do have questions tonight, you can private chat them to either Ceiling Cat or H. Foister, and we will get those answered for you. And if you are listening from somewhere else around the world, but you still have a question, you can still get that to us if you don't want to come to the chat room by sending it to theparanormalview@gmail.com, and we will get those answered. Got a great show lined up for tonight. Jeff most likely will not be with us. If he is, it'll be later on during the show because Barbara can tell you where he's at. And we have Barbara with us tonight.
Well, he's somewhere. I just don't know where. He's off filming.
He's off filming. Yeah. Yep. That's where he's at. So we got a good show. And the book that we're going to be talking about tonight got a lot in it. So we'll probably get started here pretty quick. I just want to remind everybody, if you want to go to the Gettysburg event with us this year, you need to make your arrangements for your hotels and stuff pretty soon because they're filling up. And it's for April the 13th and April the 14th. April the 13th on we will be at... it's Friday the 13th, too. So we're going to be doing an investigation at the Gettysburg Brew Works that night. And then on the 14th, we'll be doing the show live from Gettysburg Ghost something or other. What is it, Barbara? You remember?
I should have wrote it.
Yeah, Ghost Exchange. And then during the day on Saturday, we'll be out on the battlefield cruising around doing different things. We're going to have a great time. So if you want to go, let us know and sign up for it. With that, we're going to let Barbara introduce our guest.
I'm going to do that. Our guest tonight is a self-described semi-famous cult author who's written 14 nonfiction books covering history, biographies, the supernatural, historical true crime, and other bizarre subjects. His books cover incidents from nearly all of the United States. Last year, Indiana University Press published his books covering California in the Midwest, creepy California, and horror in the heartland. A book coming out later this year will feature northern and New England states, and he's currently working on a book about the West. He's a senior lecturer in the Department of English at Eastern Kentucky University. Everybody, please welcome Keven McQueen. Welcome, Keven.
Hello, thank you.
Yeah. Right. How did you get started into wanting to do these type of books?
Well, these are subjects I've always been interested in ever since childhood. The very first book I ever wrote was about the Kentucky emancipationist Cassius Clay, whose house Whitehall is allegedly haunted. And that just sort of led to other books that more fully explored the idea of haunted houses, and for that matter, just history, because I really like history.
American history or history in general?
Oh, history in general, but especially American history.
Okay. Yeah. It looks like you're well covered as far as research goes. And I'm interested, is this mostly going through archive newspapers that you come up with your ideas for books?
Mostly it is from old newspapers. I find they're gold mines of information. They're full of stories that have never really been explored, or they were famous once and then forgotten. And sometimes even more well-known stories. If you look through the old newspapers, you'll find information that has been left out of other accounts.
And it's interesting, too, when you start looking at small-town newspapers, and especially the older one circa the early 1900s, how colorful the writing was.
Oh, it's true. I've always considered the small-town journalists, the 19th century journalists, to be the best class of writers that America ever produced. And if you go to the small-town papers, you're always going to find information that the larger city papers overlook. So I always tell people, look at the local papers if you get a chance to.
Yeah, it's interesting because it looks like some of the, even the obituaries and just the straight news stories, always included these strange quotes from people, probably unverified facts that, you know, today, like the Washington Post would, you know, scream if somebody tried to include that in a news story. But it really expressed a lot of the atmosphere of the town at the time.
Yeah, I think it does, too. I always say old newspapers were some of your best sources for stories.
And some of the background to it, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You get all kinds of wonderful things.
Yeah, things that the obituaries would never show.
Yeah, you always find information, too, that you're not really looking for. Just old advertisements and things like that, which you can end up using in other books.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Henry?
Yeah. No, I'm just listening.
Oh, because I don't want to hog the conversation here, but
a whole lot tonight.
Okay, so the whole idea of writing these stories, because a lot of them take sort of a interesting, humorous but macabre journey through the Midwest. And I'm wondering, you know, was there something that spurred on this fascination for the death rituals and the death stories that you wrote?
Well, they're just the kind of topics I was always interested in, and so many people seem not to write about these things. But I've always contended that you can find as much about American history from these little stories about how people lived and what they valued. And that sort of thing.
That's very true. It's kind of, was it Benjamin Franklin who wrote, show me where you bury your dead and I'll understand how you are as a culture?
I believe he did say that.
And you know, how we write about the dead, sort of.
Yeah, history is, of course, made up of all the very big events, but I think you can learn as much from the small events, too.
Agreed. Yeah.
I think it was fascinating with as many different deaths and people being killed and stuff in the late 1800s, early 1900s. You brought a lot of that out in this book.
Well, in so many strange ways, too.
Yeah, yeah. You had one, it was in chapter 2, page 20, called The Sicilians, or Three Sicilians Hanged.
In Chicago, yeah.
Yeah, it was just a small little story, but did you want to tell us about that one?
As I recall, the three Sicilians murdered a fellow Sicilian in Chicago, and they were caught and they were hanged for it. And the rumor at the time was that one of them survived the hanging, but the people who were about to bury him realized that if they told the authorities he survived, they'd simply hang him again. So the rumor went that they nailed down the coffin and let him suffocate because they thought that would be the humane thing to do. And though it was never confirmed, one of the people in charge of burying the bodies did in fact admit that one of them apparently did survive the hanging, at least for a while.
Ouch. It's like they always get it in the end, don't they?
Yeah, really.
Your book has a lot of stories of almost premature burials.
Yeah, it's something that people don't really talk much about because I guess it's such a horrifying thing. And the tendency now is to say, well, it was just an exaggerated fear at the time. But judging from all the newspaper accounts that I've found, looking up other things, it was really not an uncommon thing at all.
Probably.
So my books have a lot of accounts of people who really did get prematurely buried, but also people who were found in the nick of time, fortunately.
Oh, there's one story you were talking about of a woman and the embalmer was there and he was putting the bleach and whatever. And I don't understand the concept of the eyelid weights.
Well, the idea, it's kind of unpleasant to think about, but during rigor mortis, sometimes the eyes would pop open. Eyelids would pop open during a funeral. And of course, they don't want people to see that. So they would, you know how they used to put coins on dead people's eyes? It was sort of the same idea. You would do that to keep them from opening their eyes in the middle of the funeral.
Do they tend to stitch them now?
Today they glue them.
Oh, they glue them?
Okay. Yeah, and the only reason I know that is I actually used to have a part-time job as a night watchman in a funeral home.
Oh, you liked that, didn't you?
Well, it was an interesting job, let's put it that way.
So, are you into the paranormal? Have you ever been on an investigation, or do you believe in ghosts?
Well, I've never been on an investigation. I certainly find it very interesting. For a number of years, I worked at Whitehall, the house that I mentioned a few minutes ago, which is supposed to be haunted. And I never really saw anything there that I thought was out of the ordinary, but I did hear some things that were pretty interesting. And in one of my books called Kentucky Book of the Dead, I've got a chapter on Whitehall, and it includes some of the things that I actually heard there.
So, yeah.
Go ahead.
I'm just curious, because if you worked at a funeral home, that you never saw any ghosts? Nothing out of the ordinary?
No, it was a very quiet place, and it would have been a great place where you would expect to see one. It wasn't a modern type of funeral home. It was an old mansion that had been converted into a funeral home. So a family actually lived there in the 19th century. So it was a very interesting building, a very old building, an old residence, regardless of the fact that it was also being used as a funeral home.
Now, you had another interesting story. On May the 23rd, 1914, a Reginald B. And I noticed a lot of times you never give the last name. You always use the last initial. Killed his girlfriend by breaking her neck. And then there's an interesting story that goes with that. That was on page 31, if you don't remember where it was at.
As I seem to recall, he tried to kill himself and failed two or three times until he finally threw himself under the wheels of a train.
Right. And he tried to poison himself twice and then couldn't do it. And then he tried to drown himself and couldn't do that either.
Yeah, this became sort of a dark comedy, the fact that he could not kill himself no matter how hard he tried.
And didn't he write a letter for when he killed himself? And in the letter, he said that he had killed his girlfriend. It was an accident.
Yes, he did.
Yeah. And why would you want to go to all that trouble to try to kill yourself? I mean, if it's an accident. Yeah.
Over an accident, too.
Well, I'm sure in those days, proving it was an accident might be a little difficult.
Yeah, probably so.
He would have ended up being hung anyway.
Probably.
Very likely. Very likely.
And they might have done a better job, maybe. Although some of the stories you had, they didn't do such a good job.
Leave it to the professionals.
Sometimes.
Sometimes.
How long did it take you to research back in the different old newspapers and stuff to find these kind of stories?
Well, I've actually spent several years at this, the better part of possibly 10 or 15 years, just whenever I would have some free time at my university, I would take a laptop and go down to the microfilm room, and I'd go through the old Louisville Courier journals on a day-by-day basis. And if I saw a good story, I would make a note of the date and the page number. And I started with 1877, and I worked my way up to the end of 1939. And it's very interesting to see these stories unfolding piece by piece. It's almost like reading a novel, except it really happened. And then when I would want to do, for example, a book on the Midwest, it was a simple matter just to go through my research and find the page numbers and the dates where I had Midwestern stories. Then I just copy the stories and I go back to my office and try to write them up in an entertaining fashion.
I know down there in Clay County, they used to have a lot of family feuds down there.
Oh, yes, they did. They certainly did.
And I was told, you know, if I went down through there, not to tell people I was a foister.
I wonder what they would do.
Probably nothing now.
Nothing. It seems to have calmed down an awful lot.
Yeah, that would have been way back in the 30s and 40s and stuff like that. So I still got all kinds of relation down there that I probably have never even met or seen. But I know that I had a relation that lives in Lexington, too. They had an uncle, I guess it was. He had a son. They named him. And then he had another son, and he went to put his name on the birth certificate. Instead of spelling it F-O-I-S-T-E-R, he spelled it F-O-S-T-E-R. So you got brothers with two different names.
Foster or Foister. Well, this is kind of off topic, but since you mentioned Clay County, and since your relatives are from there, and Barbara lives in California, the upcoming book on the West has a story about a miner from Clay County who got caught in a cave-in in a mine in California.
All right.
Back around 1906, I think it was. I wrote it up. Now I can't, off the top of my head, remember the names and the dates, but it's a pretty thrilling story. So once that book does come out, that's something you might find interesting because it could be related to you.
That could be. We'll find out.
Yeah, people don't realize that there are coal mines out here.
Yeah, this have you heard the story of Floyd Collins?
No.
No.
Well, it's a pretty famous story from Kentucky. He was a cave explorer who got trapped in a cave-in in 1925. A rock fell on his leg and he was unable to get out. And it was sort of a carnival atmosphere where the workers were trying to dig him out and people were selling hot dogs and having carnivals on the surface. And fortunately, he didn't survive. But this story made me think of the Floyd Collins story, only this miner actually did survive. It would have been about 20 years, I think, before the Floyd Collins incident.
Hmm.
So about 1905, something like that.
Isn't it interesting when you think about it, the disasters or even executions somehow brought out the picnic attitude in people?
Well, it is pretty weird to read the accounts of how people acted at these things. It's amazing to me that they had these things done in public anyway. After a certain point, they were held in in private jail yards. But even then, any buildings that were near the jail yard, people would fill the windows and hang out the windows and watch the hanging going on, or they'd climb trees or something to watch it.
Yeah, I guess that was a big thrill for everybody to do. To me, I wouldn't want to go watch somebody get hung.
I wouldn't either, but people certainly did enjoy it at the time.
That might have been their only entertainment.
Well, no television. They had to do something.
Yeah.
Well, the fact that they would subject a children to it, too.
Yeah, they would. Yeah.
Yes, they did.
Up and go out. Yeah.
In most of the accounts, it's kind of amazing, but you have... Usually it seems more women than men showed up. And they would bring their children.
I wonder why that is.
I don't know. Maybe to scare the kids into behaving.
Oh, well, that and also why more women?
I don't know. That's an excellent question. I don't feel I'm equipped to deal with that one, though. I have no idea.
I would say they wanted to see a man get punished.
Well, maybe.
Henry, that's extremely sexist.
You had a little short one I thought was kind of interesting. It was about an inventor working on explosives, and he was trying to make something that was better than dynamite, that wasn't as dangerous or wouldn't, I guess, go off so easy. Anyway, I guess the next thing you heard was a big explosion and in his laboratory, and it decapitated him.
And to put it gently, he failed.
Yeah. But it's, even though you have the desk, you have a little story kind of that goes along with these, which makes it pretty interesting.
Well, they're dark little tales, and of course they're true, but I find if you are careful about it, you can describe these things in a way that's actually, I don't know that you'd say funny, but entertaining anyway. It sort of takes the edge off the darkness if you can describe things in a way that's a bit light or humorous.
Well, it's kind of the MASH approach, which is if you don't have a sense of humor, a graveside humor, so to speak, it can be really dark and depressing.
That's true. That's a good way to put it.
You have the most unusual items in here, too, which I find really fascinating because I've never seen anybody else discuss it. And that is in your Wisconsin death trip. You have statisticians' reports from the Board of Health collecting quotations made on death certificates.
Yeah, back in the days of, that was about 1916, if I recall correctly, but all the country doctors would fill out death certificates and then mail them to the state capitol. And apparently some of the doctors described things in a rather humorous, not intentionally humorous, but in a kind of roundabout, strange way. And somebody collected those, and I found an old article in which there was a list of them, and I thought, well, that would be perfect for the book.
And you also had a lot of funny little sayings that was on tombstones, too.
Yeah, I've collected those ever since childhood. I've always been fascinated by the idea that the last thing you're ever going to say is on a gravestone, and some people take the opportunity to say something amusing or strange.
When you have a quote, though, from a death certificate that's died suddenly, nothing serious.
Yeah.
You know.
You have to wonder what that means. I assume the doctor meant died suddenly, but I don't know, not a serious disease, and yet the person died of it, so it seems like it would be serious. Unintentional humor.
Or deceased died from blood poison caused by a broken ankle, which is remarkable as the automobile struck him between the lamp and the radiator.
What could it possibly mean?
Huh? but this is a kind of book you can read before you go to bed at night and really not have nightmares.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad you point that out. It's some pretty dark stuff, but I think it's humorous enough that...
A lot of it is, yes. Yeah.
I've had people say that they would actually stay up late reading it because they couldn't put it down. But I have written some things people have told me did give them bad dreams, so I guess it just depends on exactly what's in the story and what you happen to be sensitive to.
And you've got quite a few different books with these kinds of things in them, which is fascinating, and I'm sure that we are going to get you back on for some of these.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, the new one coming out in September, the New England and Northern State book, I'm especially proud of that one. So I hope you'll have me back on to talk about that one.
Sure.
And maybe the California book. And yeah, the Western book is done.
Got that on the list.
Apparently, I'm also working on one that's simply about Kentucky. My first few books were all about Kentucky. Then I branched out to other states. But now for the first time in a while, I'm doing another one that's all Kentucky stories. It's the one that'll have the story about the miner from Clay County who went to California and got trapped in a mine.
So when you go to do these from other states, do you have to get online to find where their newspapers are, their things to be able to do search for them, or can you do it right there from Korea?
Usually I do it right from work. I can order old films on microfilm from interlibrary loan. I really need to get with the times though and learn to do it online. Although frankly, I'd really rather use microfilm. Even though it's very old fashioned, I find you keep finding all these things that you're really not looking for that are very useful that you can use in other books.
Well, microfilm takes a lot more time to go through, and I think you can stare at it longer.
Yeah, I think so. Using internet newspapers is fine if you know just exactly what you're looking for, but for the side items, the things you're not really looking for, it doesn't seem to be very good. And some of the best things turn out to be the things you really weren't looking for to begin with.
And some of these are just, you're right, they're just odd, really odd stories. You had one about being hypnotized to death.
Isn't that a weird one?
Maybe you'd like to talk about that one a little bit.
Let me see, I'm trying to remember. That was in Michigan or Wisconsin? I'm not sure which. It was Wisconsin.
Iroquois?
Yeah, back about the turn of the century, some guy was, hypnotism was a big thing at the time. It was a kind of a party game, a parlor trick, but at the same time, a lot of people were quite afraid of it. They were afraid you could be hypnotized into doing things that were antisocial or that could get you in trouble. But the story goes that a guy hypnotized a young lady and she wouldn't come out of it. And she seemed to be dead, and he slipped out of town, and she was just about to be buried when one of her friends at the graveside broke down crying and said she's not really dead, and they didn't bury her. But as the story ended, they were not able to bring her out of the trance. And there were no follow-up stories, so I actually don't know what happened. I don't know if she ever came out of it. I don't know if the hypnotist ever returned. All in all, it was a very strange story without really an ending.
Hypnotism is, I don't know, I haven't seen it done. Barbara, do you know much about it?
Yeah, but normally it's harder to keep somebody in a hypnotic state than it is to bring them out of it. So I bet you anything, she was drugged.
Oh, you know, that's a very good theory. A very good theory. That would explain a lot.
Yeah, in those days it was called mesmerizing, and it was really big, and that's what brought Rasputin out as well. About the same time, too, 1912.
Yeah, right around that time. And now that you mention it, I remember reading that sometimes hypnotists at the time would slip drugs into their subjects because, of course, it would put them in a trance and make them very suggestible. So they would use drugs surreptitiously as a means of making their hypnotism act a little bit better. Well, maybe he slipped her a drug and she just didn't come out of it.
Yeah, she overdosed.
That's a good theory. That's a very good theory. Maybe that's what happened. Yeah.
And it's interesting because it's mystery, and it's the same as going through and looking at some headstone epitaphs, is you don't know the background and you never know the ending.
That's true. I think that's another reason I've always been interested in epitaphs, is sometimes you'll get a little hint of a story and you really would love to know the story. And I think that's how I actually got interested in newspaper research in the first place, is you would see a story hinted at in a tombstone, and if you had the death date and you could find a newspaper for that week or that time, you could get the full story. And then you'd know what really happened. It's kind of like being a detective in a way, a historical detective.
Very much so. Because you can't go back and interview any of the participants, really.
True. Unfortunately, so many newspapers didn't survive, especially small-town papers, and some stories are just simply will never be known.
Yeah.
That's very true. You don't stop and think about all the small-town newspapers. They may have kept copies for archives, but the paper degraded a long time ago. And nobody's microfiche.
One good thing, one little trick I've discovered, though, is if you know the date something happened or the approximate date, even if the small town paper no longer exists, it might have been reported in other papers in nearby towns. So if something happened near Detroit and you can't find that small town paper, you get a Detroit paper for that period, and often they'll remark on what's happening in the smaller towns around them. So if you're really patient and you spend some time on it, you very often can find these mysterious little stories.
That's good to know.
Yep, sure is.
I wonder if, like, especially in some of the rural areas, if a small town newspaper reported it and then a bunch of the other little towns around it would report it at the same time.
Usually they did. So never give up. Just because the local paper doesn't have it, some paper nearby might have the story. Especially if it's something kind of grim and shocking, like a murder.
Wow. I think it's just about time to take a break, Barbara.
Okay. Shall we?
So you want to take
I'll
us out?
Do that. Folks, tonight you're listening to the Paranormal View here on the ParaX Radio Network with our very special guest author, Keven McQueen, and we will be right back after a few messages.
It's always time for the dead to shine in Hollywood. The legendary Dearly Departed Tours has stepped up their ghostly game by offering the Hollywood Ghosts and Legends Walking Tour. Dearly Departed has long been an orb of hope in the paranormal world, having been featured on television's Haunted History and Haunted Collector. Their terrible tales have been made infamous in Marla Brooks' The Ghosts of Hollywood books. The new Ghosts and Legends Tour is a 10-block, 70-minute dusk time stroll down the boulevard of broken dreams. You'll be guided through the golden age of Hollywood and see where the unearthly Bela Lugosi, Lon Chaney, and the calamitous Black Dahlia are still said to linger. You'll see Hollywood's gothic hotels, legendary theaters, and restaurants, never forgetting their permanent occupants. No stranger to investigations, Dearly Departed Tours has first-hand knowledge of some of these hauntings. For details of the Hollywood Ghosts and Legends Walking Tour, find Dearly Departed Tours on Facebook, dearlydepartedtours.com, or call 1-855-600-DEAD.
Are you psychic? Do you often have dreams that come true? Do you have an interest in hypnosis or astrology? If you'd like to learn more about classes, events, and books on metaphysics, then go to our website, www.theartofmediumship. This is Elaine Kosmaskis, director of the New England School of Metaphysics and author of The Art of Mediumship.
Hi, this is Mike from Mr. G's Ice Cream Store in Gettysburg, the most haunted ice cream store in town. Stop in and see us next time you're around. We feature 16 flavors of homemade ice cream made right here in the store. Look forward to seeing you.
So, Tim, around here at Para X, we're considered oldies because we've been here so long, right?
You know, yeah, but, you know, there's nothing wrong with oldies. In fact, you know what? I really love oldies.
Well, yeah, me too. I mean, it kind of takes me back to a time when my cauldron had training wheels and the Black Cat Lounge was called the Black Kitten Lounge. Sometimes I miss the good old days.
Sis, there's no need to miss them at all, because all you have to do is turn on and listen to Rock with the Shock.
Rock with the Who?
No, 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 little sis. No, 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 not the Who. The Shock.
I found it at last! Marla's sacred cauldron. This is the legendary artifact that has been whispered about in hushed tones for hundreds of years, and now it's mine! All mine!
Who dares defile the sanctity of my castle walls? Step away from the cauldron, you impertinent, muddy metal maltworm.
Never! I've spent half my lifetime trying to discover your age-old secret of stirring the cauldron!
Oh, for Merlin's sake, that's no deep, dark secret. Just tune into the Para-X Radio Network Thursday nights at 9 o'clock Eastern for more cauldron stirring than you can shake a wand at.
Oh, well, in that case, I guess I don't need to take up any more of your time, so I guess I'll be going!
Not just yet. We've got a little unfinished business to take care of.
That's Stirring the Cauldron with Marla Brooks every Thursday night at 9 p.m. Eastern on the Para-X Radio Network.
Hi, I am John Zaffis, and you are listening to Paranormal View on the Para-X Radio Network.
Whether you're listening at home, at work, or anywhere, thanks for making Para-X part of your day. Your source for everything paranormal, Para-X.
And welcome back, everybody, right here to the Paranormal View on the Para-X Radio Network. Want to thank everybody for taking the time to be with us. I know chat room's got quite a few people. If you got questions, feel free to private chat them to either Henry Foister or Ceiling Cat, and we will get those answered for you. And if you're listening from around the world, you can also send us questions by sending it to theparanormalview@gmail.com and just put attention question. That's good. Don't need attention, just question. And speaking of people from around the world, Barbara, are you back? Where do we have listeners tonight?
They're listening in from the United States, Australia, Canada, the United Kingdom, Germany, and Mexico. And
all right.
Vietnam checked in for a little bit.
Well, so good.
They're everywhere.
Wow. All right. Got a great guest tonight. Want to welcome back Keven McQueen.
Hello, I'm back. Thank you.
All right. And lots of good topics and stories in this book. And the book is called Horror in the Heartland. So we, there was some that, that they're longer stories, so they have a real good story to it. And if you don't remember it, I'll give you the page number if you want to kind of skim through it so you can talk about it. I thought it was a fascinating little story because I was glued the whole time trying to figure out who was doing it. But the story's called Poor Jessie is Driven to Her Grave. And that's on page 37. So while you're kind of like glancing through that, Barbara, you got anything?
Well, they're his stories, but I put his website in the chat room. Please go there, because if you think the book is humorous, his website is hysterical. And that is kevenmcqueenstories.com. And that's K-E-V-E-N McQueenstories.com. It's an absolutely wonderful website.
Well, thank you for pointing that out. I appreciate it. Also, the spelling of my name. People look for K-E-V-I-N dot McQueen, and they end up finding, you know, somebody else entirely different.
Apparently, I made that mistake, I guess, and Barbara kind of fixed it for me.
Well, I have to always tell my students on the first day of class that if they email me, remember the name spelling or I simply won't get their mail. And even then, people forget, so.
Well, I had it in front of me and still typed it wrong. That's what makes it so bad.
Well, sometimes I type it wrong.
Well, I mean, I appreciate your sense of humor, especially in a really macabre subject. And your infrequently asked questions is on the website is just hysterical. Is liquid floor wax an invention of Satan? I think you could have expounded on that a little bit more.
You know, I've completely forgotten all about that. I haven't seen it in so long, I don't even remember writing that. I'll have to go back and look it up myself now.
Yeah, I'll have to ask you a few more questions and send them to you.
Okay, sure. I'll answer them if I can.
So did you get a chance to glance over that?
Yeah, that was an Illinois story.
Uh-huh.
And very strange story. That's one that I found in the old newspapers. And I kind of hate to give it away for anyone who haven't read it, but it's a story of a young woman in Joliet, Illinois, who got all these threatening letters in the mail, threatening letters sent to boys that she met, sent to the newspapers, sent to her family, to the point that she finally committed suicide. And what happened after that, I just sort of hate to give it away, but it's a very weird story, a very weird true story.
Yeah, but and the whole time I was reading, I was trying to figure one out, who is it that's actually doing this? And I didn't see it come until the end, so.
It's almost like a Hitchcock movie, only in real life.
Yeah. No, it's a good story if people want to get the book and read that. That's excellent.
And you go from Hitchcock to Scooby-Doo, because in another section of the book, you talk about somebody who was trying to, get people to move away. So they dressed up with a sheet over their head like a ghost.
Yeah, that's exactly like something from Scooby-Doo, isn't it?
And they shot him.
Yeah, that never happens in Scooby-Doo.
Never happens. You don't shoot the ghost.
I guess it would scare the kids. I don't know.
So, yeah, like I said, it's called Horror in the Heartland, but it really, it should be labeled a comedy.
Yeah, life is like that, though. Some things that are really frightening and awful, if you just go about it the right way, describing it the right way, it actually kind of takes on a little humor to it. Which is probably a good thing, a little humor to keep it from getting too dark. It's all in the way that you describe things, word choice and that sort of thing.
And it's a retrospective too, so you have to kind of look at it from the standpoint of, okay, this happens, you know, many, many years ago.
Yeah, that makes a big difference, I'm sure. I wouldn't write about anything that happened really recently.
Yeah.
for fear that it would upset relatives. There is a story in the book from 2002, but I was careful not to give the names of anyone involved. Usually my rule is I don't write about anything that happened after 1940, but that was such a weird one I had to put it down.
Can you talk about it now?
Well, it was in Cincinnati. A woman who died in her house or apartment, and her relatives didn't report her death, and basically she mummified, where she was sitting in front of the TV and her air conditioner was running. I forget how many years her body sat in the apartment till finally the power went out, the refrigeration went out, and then people noticed she was in there.
Hmm. Oh. Yeah, smell. Yeah.
Exactly.
Wow.
There was no getting around it. And that was just such a strange story. I thought I just had to include it.
And none of her family ever come over to see her, or if she had a family, or none of the neighbors noticed whether she come in or going out, or.
Well, the only thing the news account mentioned was that they didn't report it. So yeah. I guess they had to know. They just didn't talk about it.
Hmm.
And wow. It's odd because I bet you'll find stories like that from any generation.
Yeah, you do. Human nature is so strange, and life is so strange, and throws all these strange incidents at us. Things you couldn't put in a fiction book, because if you read these things in fiction, people would say, well, I don't believe it. That could never happen. But real life doesn't have to follow any rules like that.
Yeah.
So the most bizarre coincidences that seemingly are impossible happen in real life.
And you never would suspect it. The stories that you talk about of grave robbing, for example.
Oh, lots of grave robbing stories.
And a surprising number of them in West, but I guess that's due to the number of medical schools.
Yeah, there were lots of medical schools in Ohio and Michigan. And they had pretty strict laws against grave robbery, but Indiana did not. So you'll find lots of Indiana grave robbery stories in my book. There's a few in this one. I wrote another one a few years ago called Forgotten Tales of Indiana. I would say almost a quarter of the book is Indiana grave robbing stories.
Holy smokes.
So how many times would they actually catch the people who was doing it?
Not very often. Usually if they did, the grave robbers were punished, but the medical schools were not.
Whoops. Wow. And they got to keep the graves or the cadavers, or I assume that they were using it for anatomy and then to render for the skeletons.
Yeah, they were using them for dissection purposes for medical classes, and they weren't caught too often. The business of the grave robber was to make sure the grave looked absolutely perfectly normal. And of course, usually it wasn't until somebody dug up a relative to move their body for some reason that they would open the coffin and find it empty.
And I guess the concept of what was used in I guess New England and England, the mort safes, wasn't a common practice in the Midwest.
Oh, was this a sort of...
goes over the grave.
Oh, I see. I haven't found any American cases of that happening, but I have heard of people burying bodies of relatives in concrete and scrap iron. And in the horror in the Heartland, there's a pretty funny story about a inventor who had actually invented a little cannon or gun that you would hide in a coffin. And if any grave robbers tried to open it, they'd get a face full of buckshot.
Whoa. Booby trapping classic.
And I do know. Yeah, they would... It's not very easy to describe, but a little tiny gun called a needle gun would be attached to the inner lid of the coffin and then attached to the body. So if you tried to move the body, you'd get shot at.
Huh.
And in the book, I speculate how many of these little grave cannons are still underground that nobody knows about. in one of the books, Forgotten Tales of Indiana, I think it was, there's a story about a man who actually buried his wife with a charge of nitroglycerin.
Really?
Yeah, and it was, apparently the word got out and no one bothered to try to steal her body from the grave, but I wonder, to this very day, there may be all this nitroglycerin down there that nobody really knows about when they go walking around in the cemetery.
Wonder if it loses its intensity over time.
I'm not sure, but
yeah,
maybe. If you ever go in that cemetery, walk carefully.
Tread lightly.
You get in that area.
So I'm going to alert my cemetery photography friends that if they're going to go out shooting photography, they might want to be careful when they walk across some of these graves.
Stay on the path.
Just never know what's down there.
I had not heard of a gun trap in a coffin. That is just amazing.
I can only assume they weren't very widespread. I only found one case in which someone actually opened it and actually got fired at. Of course, there may be many examples out there that I never found, but I do know it happened at least once.
That practice pretty much stopped. I know that they put some people put cement slabs over their graves for the very same purpose for body snatchers.
What a lot of families used to do is they would simply hire somebody, or they do it themselves. They would just simply camp out near the grave with weapons. And after staying there a couple weeks, the body spoils to the point that no one's going to try to steal it.
And you mentioned a story of two grave guarders. And I guess that somebody had hired him and another group hired another group. And they ended up shooting each other?
Oh, yeah. They didn't know about each other, so they came to the logical conclusion that each group was there to steal the body, and they fired on each other.
Huh. I didn't see that one.
I think that was in Indiana, too. Wow. Indiana seems to be the place where most of the grave robbery stories took place, because it was such an industry there.
So I have a question from the chat room, and she wants to know, which cemetery had the nitro in it, because she doesn't want to go there.
Off the top of my head, I'm not sure. It's in the book Forgotten Tales of Indiana.
There you go, Tina. So you need to buy the book.
If she wants to email me, I'll try and find it and tell her about it.
She lives in Indiana. That's what she was wanting to know.
Oh, I see. If only I could remember the name of the town, but off the top of my head, I'm not sure. I've written 14 books and with hundreds of stories in them, and I simply have a hard time remembering details sometimes.
Well, you had one in here. It was a woman, Lucy W., died in Kokomo on September 1st, 1901, after flinging herself down a flight of stairs and then starving herself. She had tired of life at the age 122.
Yeah.
I guess she was kind of done, huh?
I guess so.
So she tried to throw herself downstairs and couldn't kill her, and then she starved herself.
Yeah, I can't help but think there may be more to the story than we know about, but that was all that the papers were telling.
But on the other hand, you also tell stories, some of them are quite sad, and the one of the 14-year-old boy who went off in a lightning storm and shot himself because he just simply had enough. And it makes you kind of wonder. I know that kids were a lot different back then. They were a lot more grown up in a lot of ways.
Yeah, there are some stories like that where you just never find out the full story, and it's something of a mystery. I don't know, maybe it's better that way. Sometimes it's better not to know the whole thing. But you can't help but wonder what inspired him to do that.
So is there one story that you just, it's kind of like your Moby Dick, your whale that you have to try to hunt down and find the answers to?
Oh, quite a few. But You know, you just try and you try, and you just finally reach the point where you realize no matter what, you're just never going to get the full story. Earlier, I mentioned you can sometimes get more details from other local papers, not necessarily from the town involved, but from nearby. But there are some things that I guess, you know, you'll never know.
So is there one story that has affected you more than the others?
Nothing I can think of off the top of my head. There's a lot of them where I really wish I could have met the people involved.
Some of them are quite colorful.
Yes, they are.
Every once in a blue moon, not often, but I'll hear from relatives of the people
really?
In the books. It doesn't happen much. It's kind of interesting when it does.
Is it that they've read it and go, oh, I recognize what happened?
Sometimes they do. Usually I don't edit out names of people. Indiana University Press wanted me to alter the names of a lot of people in the book. And some cases I would point out, and for example, with famous crimes, there's really no point in trying to leave people's names out because they're already well known on the internet. In the cases of, I don't know, suicides or things like that, I can kind of see where you would want to shorten somebody's name. But these new books are the only ones in which I've done that. Generally, I give full names. I feel it's all part of the historical record.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, sure. Yeah, they can get online and look it up and find it, too.
Well, that's true. I mean, even where the names are truncated or left out, if you just Google for a few seconds, I'm sure you can get the full names of almost all the people there. Maybe not all of them, but most of them. And I find most people really are not offended if you write something about their ancestors, even if they did something really horrible. They almost seem to be proud of it sometimes.
Now you had one that was really interesting. And it's unsolved. It was a woman in the furnace, and that was on page 63.
Oh, yeah.
That was a real interesting story.
Yeah, that was an Illinois story.
Yeah.
That was a strange one. There's lots of possible logical answers, but nothing that really fully covers all the circumstances.
It wasn't too much that they was able to prove either, because... Won't you tell about what happened to the woman to start with? Now, I don't see how that happened. How could you do that to yourself? And it just really unbelievable. I mean, what happened to her?
Well, her name was Elfrida Knack, and they found her. She had been burned in a furnace in a courthouse basement or a police department basement. Off the top of my head, I'm not quite sure, but she did survive at least for a week or two.
Yeah.
And the theory was that she actually put herself in there, which seems pretty absurd. And then the theory became that one of the local policemen did it, but they were never really able to prove it. And so it's sort of a mystery to this day.
Yeah,
they went through a strange story.
They went through a lot of different scenarios and people, and I think she had also left a note. But her hair was burned off. Her face was burned. Her arms were all burned. Her feet and legs were burned. Said even burned some toes off too. And she was standing up beside the furnace when they come and found her.
Yeah. That's, when they found her, she was out of the furnace.
Yeah. So
nothing really makes much sense there. There's a lot of theories you could come up with, but none of them really seem to cover all the circumstances.
Yeah, she would have had to climb into the furnace and then climb back out again.
And climb back out.
Well, I don't know if she got all the way in or if she just had the door open and stuck her limbs and head in. And
yeah, a lot at a time.
But still, I mean, when you get close to a hot fire, you're going to back off. I mean, unless somebody's throwing you or holding you in, I mean, you're going to get out of it.
They weren't even sure how she got in the basement in the first place because it was locked up.
Yeah.
And they asked her if she did it to herself, and she'd say yes. And then they'd ask her again, and she'd say no.
Yeah.
So she'd say he did it. Sometimes she'd say they did it.
Right.
And nobody really knows.
Right, because she was in and out of consciousness. And that's why they never got that much out of her, of actually what happened or took place. So there's a lot of mystery and unanswered questions. They couldn't pin it on anybody, so it's still unsolved.
It's one of the stranger stories, I think, that I ever found. And it's not very well known.
No. We got stories like that around Hamilton. I grew up with some people that had lived down the street from me, and I used to go down there and babysit, kind of. I mean, a couple of them was younger. Then I guess one of the guys, he was close to my age. I was still like 14, 15, something like that. And I'd go down there and do that, and we was good friends and stuff. When I went into service and come to find out, they had been a murder. I guess the kid's mom had got killed, and one of the daughters was over when it happened. But she said that it was this other guy who did the killing, and he ended up going to prison. She didn't get anything out of it, but it was a love triangle between her mom, and this other guy.
Oh.
Yeah. And so, and I knew him, you know, so, but I was in the service and come back and find that happened. Wow. That's scary like that.
So this was at Hamilton, Ohio?
Uh-huh. That was back in the 70s, probably. I would say in the mid-70s, maybe.
Well, there's a really good book about Cincinnati crimes called Queen City Gothic. I think the author was J.T. Townsend, and then he did a sequel, but I don't think he did that story. And maybe he should do that in one of his in a future book.
Yeah, it's a good story. But that's one of those weird murder things. And Hamilton's got its share of those type of things.
Just about every community does. And the larger the community, the more you get.
Yeah, sure does.
And so, speaking of weird murders, you have a story in here that is just so bizarre. And that is a collector of heads.
Oh, yeah. That's another one that you would think would be really famous, and yet it isn't.
No.
I had never heard this story before.
And I had it here on my list, a collection of heads and worse. Yeah.
Well, that's a good example of how the things you find when you go through the newspapers. That was one where it just unfolded a little at a time. Then he dropped out of the headlines, and then he came back in the headlines a few years later. And because I had everything in a document, I was able to do a word search. I thought his name sounded familiar, and I found out, oh, yeah, this was the guy who got in trouble for having a trunk full of skulls a few years before he was arrested down in Mississippi.
Yeah, I guess he had lived in a house and sold the house, and the people that moved in found the trunk with
a skull. A trunk full of skulls, and didn't take it with him.
Yeah. And so they traced it back to him. Yeah.
And he was already in jail for robbing a grave, so it's not like he'd never done it before.
Well, they didn't get him for killing the people, just grave robbing, right?
Yeah, the original trunk full of skulls, they never really found out how he got those, but probably grave robbery. Then when he got out of jail, it was at Michigan? I think it was Michigan.
Yeah.
He went back. He went down south to Mississippi, and then he got in real trouble for murdering an entire family. In fact, he cut pieces off one of them, and apparently had tried to eat the pieces.
Oh,
so, yeah, he ended up getting hanged for that, and I couldn't help but compare him with Ed Gein, because here you have a Midwestern grave-robbing, murdering cannibal from about 30 years before Ed Gein.
Who pretty much wasn't doing this for selling these to in like hospitals and medical schools.
Yeah, apparently he was just collecting body parts and heads for the fun of it.
Gotta love these people. Yeah. And it's interesting because around this time would have been H.H. Holmes.
Yeah, that would have been, oh, let's see, H.H. Holmes, I think, he was hanged in 1896, yeah. If I recall correctly.
A little bit.
And the guy we're talking about here, Coiner, mm-hmm. I think it was Jerry Coiner. He was around in the 1920s. I think he was hanged in around 1935, something like that.
Yeah. Tina put in the chat room, trunk or treat.
Oh, that's what I wish I'd called it. Too late now, but that would have been a great title.
Yeah.
And the fact that children found the trunk to begin with, and were using them as toys.
Isn't it amazing how often in these stories kids find bodies and skulls and things?
It's like a good beginning of a good movie.
Yeah, it does. It's like a really, really bad joke, only it's true.
The more you get into these stories, the deeper you go, and the more you don't want to put the book down.
thank you, I appreciate it.
I keep telling people this. It may sound like it's a terribly scary, awful book, but it isn't. These are very human stories, and there is a touch of humor to it. And I don't think anybody will be kept awake at night, but.
Thanks. No. Well, I try to strike that balance between scary and funny. I figure if you can make something that's scary and funny at the same time, then you've really done something.
Well, you had another one. And once you start reading these, I don't know, two or three page stories, they get interesting and you have to read the whole thing, without putting it down to find out what's going on. It was one called Bad Advice from the Spirit World, and that was on page 45.
That was another one I found by going through the old papers and was very surprised to find that the story was almost unknown. I don't see why that's not more well-known than it is.
But you hear a lot of different stories kind of like that. She married somebody, and he ended up dying, and she collected a insurance policy, and then somebody else died. She had an insurance policy on, got that, and then she married again. He died and got money on that, and then
brother-in-law and two or three or four children.
Right, and she was
possibly
getting
money. A neighbor.
Yeah,
it just took them forever to finally catch her.
Yeah, which was interesting. I guess it was a big trial. She kept saying that she didn't do anything, and they kept saying they found, like arsenic, I guess it was, in the bloodstreams or in the bodies. But then some of the different types of medicine, because all these kids were sick before, and she was mixing medicine to give to them. And so the doctor issued medicine for them, and they were saying, well, the medicine the doctor issued had some in it, or a low dose or whatever, but if they had this, that could change the composition. And so they was having a hard time proving that she actually did it to an extent. It ended up a good story.
Thank you. Well, they kind of had a point there, because a lot of patent medicine at the time actually had traces of arsenic and dangerous things, and embalming fluid had arsenic in it. And finally, they were able to prove, though, that the poison in their bodies was just so much of it that there's no way it came from a little patent medicine or even embalming fluid.
Yeah. She ended up getting hung, I believe, didn't she?
I believe they gave her a life sentence, but she died of cancer a couple years after she was sentenced. So it was a short life sentence.
Right.
And then again, you have the story of somebody going to a soda fountain shop and asking for a drink and somehow getting served formaldehyde.
I know. I mean, how in the world does that happen? That was in Kansas. And the bottle wasn't even labeled formaldehyde. It was labeled Hunyadi water, mineral water, which was a popular mineral water at the time. So somebody mislabeled it very badly. You just have to wonder how these things happen.
I mean, it's not like there wasn't quality control in those days, but makes you wonder if there was something else nefarious happening.
Well, there was a similar story in the book about during the famous anarchist riots in Chicago, how a bunch of anarchists broke into a drugstore. Well, not really a drugstore, was it? It was a liquor store. And they took a bottle of something that they thought was whiskey, and they passed it around, and it turned out to be, some kind of acid. And they drank it, sure enough.
That'll hurt.
Oh, yeah. Yes, it did.
Bad, I mean.
Yeah. I think I made the joke in the book that even if you're an anarchist, you really should read the labels on bottles anyway. Well, that calls to mind another story in the book about a guy who found a bottle of red fluid in his house in the shelf, and he thought it was wine, and he just opened it and just drank the whole thing down in a gulp, and it turned out to be not wine but embalming fluid.
Oh,
I thought that was a pretty horrifying thing. They used to embalm people at home instead of in funeral parlors. And recently his wife's cousin, if I recall correctly, had been embalmed in the house, and the funeral director left a bottle behind.
Okay. Now, this is kind of morbid, but I'm going to ask anyway. To embalm somebody, you would basically remove their blood and add the embalming fluid. Or at least that's, yeah.
Yes.
So they would.
That's how they do it now. And that's how they did it then, too. They would just attach a needle, put it in the vein, and then draw the blood out and then pump the fluid back in.
All that usually the living room table, right?
Yeah.
You see, yeah, there's why I don't live in the past. I'm glad I lived, yeah.
Yeah. It's nice to be nostalgic, but when you read about all the old diseases and things, you're kind of glad that you're actually here.
Well, yeah, you know, we take it for granted, but we don't live in a day when there are body snatchers and things like this happening that we're aware of.
Yeah, that's true.
Huh. Well, Barbara, I think it's about time for us to take our last break.
We're having fun. folks, you're listening to the Paranormal View here on the ParaX Radio Network with our very special guest, author Keven McQueen, author of Horror in the Heartland. And we will be right back after a few messages.
We all go through life secure in the knowledge of who we are. But what would you do if one day you found out that you grew up in a family that wasn't quite as normal as you were led to believe? You see, the world around us is very complex. It's made up of many layers. And when you start to peel back those layers, either by choice or by accident, you just might discover a hidden truth. The magical world and the mortal worlds are intermingled, with no physical boundary between them. It's all a matter of perception. In Shelley Gordon's case, it's also a matter of destiny. And what she uncovers about herself after her chance encounter with Timothy Titchmarsh, a mysterious little old man with a twinkle in his eye, changed her life completely. He told her of shocking, carefully guarded family secrets that had been unspoken for many generations. But the biggest shock of all was learning that she was not only a witch, but the great-granddaughter of an elite sorceress who tragically died before she could carry out a vital and perilous task that Shelley was now fated to complete. The thought of having to learn the craft, integrate herself into the magical world, and risk her life to finish the task is enough to give anyone a bad case of the collie wobbles. Marla Brooks' new fiction book, A Bad Case of the Collywobbles, is now available at Amazon.com in both paperback and Kindle formats. Visit her website at marlabrooks.com to find out more.
Hey there. I don't know if you've heard, but there's a great new radio show on Para X. Two hosts, 1 hour, and too much fun. Bethany and I not only talk about the latest goings-on in the supernatural worlds, they live it. They want to hear from you. They want to help you understand and guide you. And they want you to tune in. So, grab a friend or come alone to gather around that metaphysical table with Heidi and Stephanie. If you're interested in the worlds of the unseen, tune in to The Gathering Radio Show, Tuesdays at 9 p.m. Eastern on Para X Radio.
Hi, this is Master Tarot Card Reader Ken Bogle, and I highly encourage you to tune in every Monday night to the Para X Radio Network for The Para Cave, hosted by Matt Gesso, as he goes in search of the truth in the supernatural, metaphysical, mystic, and paranormal. Monday nights, 8 p.m. Eastern, only on the Para X Radio Network. I never miss it, neither should you.
Rhett, where are you going?
I'm going back to the Paranormal View, back where I belong.
Please, take me with you.
No, I'm through with everything here. I want to see if there's something left in life I haven't explored. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Oh, Rhett, don't run to them. They talk about ghosts and hauntings, UFOs and all kinds of supernatural scary stuff.
You'll never understand, will you, Scarlet?
No!
Well, that's your misfortune.
Rhett, if you go, where shall I go? What shall I do?
Frankly, my dear. Line.
Oh, you gotta be kidding.
That's the Paranormal View with your host, Henry Foister, Jeffrey Gould, and Barbara Duncan. Every Saturday night at 8 p.m. Eastern, exclusively on the Para-X Radio Network.
Hi, this is Hollywood haunt writer Marla Brooks, and you're listening to the Para X Radio Network.
There's a darkness in the hallway. Voices that seem to come from nowhere. Alone at night, there is a feeling that something or someone is near. Where can you go? Who can you turn to? Para X Radio. Our knowledgeable host and expert guest can help you find some answers and take a glimpse into the unknown. Para X Radio, programming for the open mind.
And welcome back, everybody, right here to the Paranormal View on the Para X Radio Network. I want to thank you for taking the time to be with us tonight, those in the chat room and those listening from around the world. We appreciate each and every one of you. Tonight, I got with us Barbara Duncan.
I'm still here.
And Jeff is not with us tonight. He's on a film shoot. So hopefully he'll be back with us next week. I want to welcome back our guest. excuse me. Keven McQueen with his book, Horror in the Heartland.
Hello, I'm still here.
That stuff's still getting down in my throat and making me cough. So anyway, we're glad to have you. Got still lots to talk about and a great book. So we're going to let you tell everybody a little bit later where they can go about getting all these books.
Okay.
And but there's you've got a whole lot of them in here that's really good. You had one. That was on page 145. It was called It's Hammer Time. And that was a cute little story.
Well, that's another one that for some reason isn't that well known. I try not to write about stories that have already been done a million times because I really don't feel I can add anything new to them. But this was an Ohio story, and it was a woman named Velma West back in the 1920s who killed her husband with a hammer because he didn't want to let her go play a bridge game.
That's justifiable.
Well, they ended up putting her in prison over it.
Yeah, she got off pretty lightly. It was a very strange thing because the defense basically said, well, we don't want her to even go to trial. We're willing to just let her go to jail. And the prosecution said, well, okay, we agree with you. So I think they just didn't want to put her in the electric chair and they were looking for a way to get her in prison as fast as possible and not really have a trial.
But while she was, I guess, in prison, she was, I guess, coming up for a chance to be paroled, and they didn't want to let her out.
And she actually escaped, too.
Yeah.
Not for long, just for a few weeks. And then she went back to prison, so that's where she died, I think 1958 or 9.
59, I believe, is when it was, yeah. Go ahead, Barbara.
Wow. I mean, you can kind of understand it probably, they just, the cost of the trial and the sensationalism of it.
Well, she wasn't that old. Was she under 20 or at 20, something like that?
I believe she was in her early to mid 20s.
Yeah.
Wow.
And this took place when, in the 30s, wasn't it?
If I remember correctly, it was about 1927.
Okay, yeah. It was close to 30, yeah.
So,
interesting story, though.
Okay, back to the graves. You have, like, stuff that I never would believe that anybody found, and it's just fascinating to me. And that is the story of the patent that was given to prevent premature burial. And it was like a dollhouse that contained a miniature coffin attached to rubber tubes, so it could show you how a person could be buried, not be dead, be able to get out of the coffin and climb up the ladder inside the house, and then to alert people that he wasn't dead, or just basically go home.
Yeah, just put on a nice, clean pair of clothes left in the house and open the door with a key and then go on home and tell everybody, hey, guess what? I'm not really dead. Here I am. It was a little model made and sent to a patent attorney. There were lots of really strange devices people created at the time to alert people if someone had been prematurely buried. One of the more famous is there was a long tube that would lead from the grave to the surface, and if you were woke up in your coffin, you could yank a string and it would make a flag come up.
Oh, lovely. I know the one of the bells where there's a lever that you could pull in and would ring a bell above your grave.
Yeah, that was true too. Edgar Allan Poe wrote a whole story called The Premature Burial, which was all about a man's attempts to prevent that very fate.
It didn't work in his case, but...
Yeah. As I recall, he also had a coffin where you could pull a string and a flag would come up. I may be misremembering that part, but Poe did write a story about it.
But people were afraid of it. I assume that happened more often than people. There were enough people that were just on the brink of being embalmed or buried that woke up that it could create a fear.
I guess it happened often enough that people were certainly worried about it. And there are some cases in the books where you'll see people leaving in their will that they don't want to be buried until they've been dead for a week or two, and people requesting that they be shot in the head or the heart after death just to make sure they were dead.
Wow. I guess it would make sense.
Yeah, definitely tell something about the fear they had.
Well, in a very real one, because until, you know, EEGs came along and you could actually determine that there was brain death, well, even today, people wake up in the morgue. Not in the United States.
But... Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember reading cases of it happening in places like China or Bogota.
Babies waking up. Yeah. There's a lot of that. Yeah. Ick.
You had one in February 1923, Marietta C. of Chicago schemed up a clever way to kill herself while masking the true cause of her death. She put poison in a bottle of laxative salts. The plan worked to perfection, but had an unintended consequence when, on March 14th, her sister Anna unsuspectingly went to the medicine chest and guess what she took?
Yeah, I thought that was a good place to end it. Sort of on a cliffhanger there that anybody could figure out.
Yeah. Bad way. Bad way. I have never thought that I could be in a situation where I'd want to do myself in.
Yeah, me either, but it's amazing the creativity some people have shown.
A different time period, too. Yeah.
Well, yeah.
And there was one that you talked about in Michigan of a person trying to hold their breath.
Yeah, which you would think wouldn't work, but apparently at least once it did.
I'm trying to figure that one out. How she could hold her breath so long as to actually die from that. Because normally when you pass out, you start breathing again.
Yeah, I couldn't figure that out either. And the newspapers really weren't any help there.
So, yeah. Like I said, you keep going through these stories, folks, and you go chapter after chapter, and it's like, now what?
That's the... That would be a good title for a book. I should call one Now What. Let's tell somebody if they ever anthologized any of those stories into one collection, it should be called Things Not to Do.
Or I wonder how they did that. Yeah, like this one with the lady who held her breath to kill herself. It's like, how did you do that? It's just amazing.
If only we had more details from the papers, but they didn't really explain it.
Well, and I know that even those days that there's the parts of hospital procedures and records that they weren't allowed to publicize.
Well, yeah, that's true.
So you never know. And until you can get into the hospital records, and I don't think that's ever going to be possible.
No, probably not. Not at this date.
Go ahead. Like chapter after chapter, and it's a now what? And you had one, I guess, closing remarks or last statements of people. His name was Henry J. He hung and shot himself in a shed on this farm. Leaving a note to his wife saying, now you have a chance to get a third husband. For God's sakes, don't talk him to death.
Yeah, there's a story there, I'm sure.
And it makes me wonder, did they actually print that in the newspaper?
Yeah, that actually was in the paper.
Wow.
You had another unsolved murder case, too, called the Mad Butcher of Kingsbury Run. And
yeah.
That was page 126. He was even hunted by Elliot Ness and Peter Merlot.
Yeah, now that actually is a famous story. It's been the subject of even some books. But the only reason I decided to write about that one was I found some information that I thought I had not seen in any other books about it. So I thought it was sort of justifiable to write about it, even though it had already been told many times.
But still, it's good. It's a good story, though. Yeah.
That's one of the creepier unsolved serial killing stories, I think, from American history.
Just putting in the chat room, if you can, people believe these stories, and I guess in this situation that sometimes life is a lot more surreal than fiction.
Yeah, I like to call it real life surrealism. It's sort of a phrase that I've coined to describe what's in these books. I can't think of a better way to describe it. It's very strange and surreal and seemingly impossible, or at least improbable, and yet these are things that actually did happen. Proving that real life can be much stranger than fiction.
In this case, definitely. And in one instance of art imitating life and the theatrical realism of an amateur actor rehearsing a play, and there was a prop gun. And
yeah, it's surprising how often that kind of thing has happened.
Really? Okay.
I have similar incidents in some of my other books, just people using prop guns but not really looking before shooting them and firing real bullets from the stage, sometimes into the audience, sometimes into their fellow actors.
And even a high school student was shot during a rehearsal where somehow they substituted a real gun for a toy gun. And I assume that's probably a lot easier to do back then, where there wasn't the regulation of guns.
Yeah, somebody wasn't paying any attention, that's for sure.
But again, folks, these stories are not told morbidly. They're very factual, and there's a lot of lightheartedness in there too. So I don't have any trouble reading them or recommending them to anyone.
Yeah, they're not necessarily written in graphic kind of, but just what kind of basic happened. Like, excuse me, on June 21st, 1908, a woman from Sunbury flung herself in front of a southbound Cleveland, Akron, and Columbus passenger train. Most of her remained in Sunbury, but her head, which lodged on the locomotive's coal car, went for 340-mile journey through rural Ohio's lovely scenery before anyone noticed. She wanted to see the sights one more time.
Maybe it's just me. I know it's a terrible thing, but there's just something about it, you know, that just, it approaches humor
yeah.
in a strange kind of way. In one of my other books, I have a case about a woman who poisoned her husband to get his insurance money, which, of course, would be a very tragic thing, but she wanted rid of him so badly, she poisoned him with four different poisons at the same time and thought she would get away with it. And just to me, that kind of detail makes it cross the line from tragedy into very dark comedy.
Yeah.
Let's see, you got one called Closing Remarks, Ohio. Alexander S. shot himself in a Cincinnati government building on September 21st, 1908. He left a suicide note reading, "To whom it may concern. Why? Old age, sickness, threatened insanity, enough to make the tired soul seek the immortal dawn." I guess he was tired of living.
I guess so. Just like the 122-year-old woman from Indiana, Kokomo.
Yeah.
And these suicide notes are published as well?
Yeah, apparently the journalists of the time didn't really have any problem with that. So you find these suicide notes in the paper, some of which are very tragic, but some of which are just bizarre, almost to the point of being funny. Or at least very, very strange.
I'm not talking, yeah. And then there's a lovely story, and I hope you can talk a little bit about this, and that is the Consumed by Rats.
Oh, yeah. It's actually three different places in the book. I think there's a Iowa story of Consumed by Rats, an Indiana story, and one toward the very, very end of the book. So I'm not really sure which one that
Cheney and Fletcher, that's at the end of the book, I think. Yeah.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah, that was it
Michigan?
I think it was Michigan. They found a body on the road, and they couldn't figure out exactly what had happened to him, but he was in a very chewed up condition, and they hauled his body back to the courthouse to examine, to do an autopsy or a court proceeding of some sort. And while they were in the middle of it, another man came running into the room and said he had gone to the site of where the body had been found and had been attacked by swarms and swarms of rats. So everybody assumed that the man on the road who had died had actually been killed and chewed up by rats.
That's a way to go.
Yeah, this also apparently was not that uncommon. The New England book coming out in September has some hair-raising stories about encounters with rats.
Oh.
So I'm kind of afraid of rats myself. Those were not very pleasant stories to write.
Oh, this one here was a hair-raising one. It says, as Bert Walker sat in the electric chair at the Ohio State Penitentiary on November 10th, 1930, he said to the witnesses, a rather shocking evening. Some might argue that he deserved a death penalty for that pun, if for no other reason.
People say all sorts of crazy things, don't they?
So
oh,
do you
yeah.
try to write yeah. In a format of a little bit of everything at once, or are there different, is it regional? Are there certain things that are just more New England versus California versus Midwest?
It's all location, really. The books are similar in form. It's just the stories are different because they're from different areas. So when writing the book, I would go through all my notes and I'd say, okay, I'm going to get all my Michigan stories together here and all my Iowa stories here, all the Nebraska stories here. And while working on the book about the West, originally the California book was part of that book, but it turned out that the California section was so long it could actually make a book of its own. And that's what happened. So the rest of the book will be coming out eventually, all the Western states except California.
Do things stand out, like the rat stories, for example, versus, say, California, where there might be more snake stories or something along those lines?
I'm trying to remember. I don't think there's any rat stories in the California book, although you will find lots of snake stories. And one of the books is all about the South. It was published by Pelican Publishing. And it's called, let me see, Gothic and Strange, True Tales of the South. And it has a number of snake stories in it.
And probably some alligators, too.
Yeah, hopefully it'll make you laugh. But if you're afraid of snakes, these might not be things to read right before you go to sleep.
Hey, you had one here. 5-year-old daughter of a couple seemed to die at Hanston on August 11th, 1901. On the way to the cemetery the next day, a bolt of lightning allegedly hit the metallic casket and opened it, whereupon the child sat up and asked for her mama.
Creepy, isn't it?
Yeah. Doesn't say what she died from or what they thought she died from.
I wonder. It's probably something the newspaper hadn't mentioned. usually I try to include details like that when I can. Just to add a little extra level of interest.
Well, this one here was a funny one. George S. held on a charge of rape was removed from the courtroom in Omaha on October 18th, 1891 by a mob determined to hang him. George expired from fright, but the vengeful mob beat his corpse and hanged it from the wire anyway.
It seems so pointless.
Yeah.
I guess they made their point to everybody else.
Yeah. You got, you had another one, which was an interesting story. It was about a minister, and it was called, I believe it was The Devil and His Works. That was on page 206.
Oh, right. Another Michigan story.
Yeah.
That was a strange one. That was another one involving hypnotism.
Right. And it ended up, I guess, it's a real good story. They need to read it.
It was another one with a sort of Hitchcockian twist to it.
Right, yeah. And it had, I guess he was a pastor at three different churches around close to each other in three different cities, I guess. And it ended up to where something happened, and you have to read it because it is a mystery. I'm not going to tell it to people, but it's a real interesting story.
Yeah, that was another one that just somehow never got much attention.
Yeah.
It was so strange you'd think that it would. The New York Times actually covered part of it at the time.
Tina says, I live in Indiana, and yes, Michigan definitely has issues.
One story that really got me, and that is in which Benny gazes up at himself. Because I had not heard of this.
Yeah, either. How about that? I thought that one was kind of a good way to end the book, because it was so way out there that there was simply no way to top it. I'm not even sure how to summarize that.
I'm trying to figure out.
It's so weird.
Weird stuff. So it's kind of a horror film. It's kind of a decapitation story. It's almost, yeah, it was like a cult.
And it's another one that was never really officially solved, too.
It's like, never... I don't ever recall seeing these. And it really, folks, you got to read the story because it is really out there. The crime scene is just like maddening.
It had to be one of the grossest crime scenes in the history of American
with
crime.
Some of the strangest stuff in there. He was sitting at a desk, but his head was missing, and on the wall, there's a crucifix and a print of the Last Supper and all sorts of really odd, grotesque things. Wow. And it never made the, there's no books about it. And as far as I know, wasn't much of a news story, a lasting news story anyway.
Spoke about it. I think the crime writer J. Robert Nash mentioned it in one of his books, but some of his information was incorrect, and I was able to correct some of it.
He did have an occult book, and there was sort of an occult reference to it, I guess.
Yeah, this guy, the man who was murdered, his name was Benny Evangelista, and he wrote his own, I don't know how to describe it. He called it his own Bible, but it's a very cultish kind of book. I'm very proud to announce that I actually own a copy of it. It's been reprinted. You can buy a copy of it, but what I have is actually a first edition. It's unreadable. It's just absolutely bizarre.
The oldest history of the world?
Yeah, and some people think that he and his family were murdered in such a way that duplicated some of what he wrote about in his cult manual. That's not giving away too much. There.
And folks, the story, if it's like, wow. Because he sold a lot of occult items, and almost like a voodoo sort of approach to magic. You know, do you think that he was murdered by locals who just had enough of what he was doing?
It's hard to say. Apparently, a lot of people were mad at him over everything from real estate swindles to his having started what would essentially be called a cult now. It's really kind of hard to say. Usually, I try to aim for stories that are frightening in a way, but can be described in a humorous way. That one was just, that's one that actually could give you a bad dream. I thought it was a good way to end the book.
And in the 1930s, too, which is about the time that mesmerism and spiritualism were kind of at a peak.
Yeah, they're taking off real big again.
And the other occultist groups that were happening at the time.
Yeah, he was sort of using that to make money. He was exploiting his fellow immigrants' beliefs in these things, which could be another reason people were angry with him. But whatever happened, they took it out on him and his entire family as well.
In a very, very brutal sort of crime scene. And I'm glad there are no pictures.
I know. I wonder if anyone even took pictures.
Well, when you come across a lot of these stories, is there ever a picture associated with them?
Not very much. Most of these are stories from the 19th century to the early 20th century. So not usually.
Yeah. So they wasn't taking pictures then anyway.
Yeah, they didn't do much crime scene photography up until, about the 1910s or so. It had been done a few times, like in the Lizzie Borden crime.
Right.
But not very often. It was sort of a rarity.
I was just going to ask you about that. In your research, do you ever try to fact check and try to talk to the local police and see if those records are available?
A few times I have. I wrote a book in which I mentioned the very notorious, still unsolved New Orleans Axeman crimes from the 1910s. Yes. And I actually did get a chance to communicate with some of the officials down there, but unfortunately most of the records are lost. And they did send me photocopies of some of the original police records, which was really a neat thing to see.
Wow. We have...
And there were some contradictions between the police records and the newspaper reports that it was really hard to decide who had it right.
We have two hosts on Para-X. Both live in New Orleans. Both of which are ex-police officers.
And oh, wow.
They're really into the Axeman story.
Oh.
We'll have to...
Yeah, there's been two or three books about it lately. There was the one I wrote. That came from a collection of Southern true crime stories called The Axeman Came From Hell and other Southern true crime stories. And then there was... I just can't remember the name of the book. It was there was another one, though, a very good one called The Axeman of New Orleans by Miriam Davis. It came out last year. That's a really good one. I highly recommend that one. She corrected a lot of errors that you see about the case.
And it was also sort of woven into American Horror Story when they did that. In New Orleans.
Yeah, that's where most people seem to have heard of it from. If I mention it to my students at all, that's always where they heard of it.
Instead of, Ella was part of Herbert Asbury's French Quarter.
Yes.
But nobody reads those books.
Yeah. Too bad. Yeah,
he wrote some really good books.
His book on the Barbary Coast was really, really good.
Yeah, I still have it and still look at that book quite often because the Barbary Coast was wild.
I think he wrote The Gangs of New York, didn't he?
Yeah.
Which was made for the Martin Scorsese movie.
And he wrote one on Chicago.
Yes, yes he did, but I don't remember the title of that one.
He wrote one called Sucker's Progress, which is about the history of gambling in the United States.
I think he wrote most of his in the 1920s.
Fascinating stories. Fascinating stories. But it's interesting that to be able to go back to police records, because I don't know what the statute of limitations is for some of the stories, to be able to see if there are crime photos or police reports.
It seems to vary from community to community. And it's really hard to find original reports, even original crime scene photos. A lot of detectives, when they retired, they would actually take the photos and the files and keep them as souvenirs, and so they'd get scattered.
So that includes, like, crime scene evidence?
Yeah. Especially photos.
Well, didn't somebody actually take some of Lizzie Borden's items as well?
I don't think so. I think those are actually, most of those are still in a museum now, I think, in Fall River, yeah. Massachusetts.
In Villisca, the crime scene was pretty much
Iowa.
Picked clean by locals going in and grabbing things.
Yeah, they would do that. It's really shocking to read all these old newspaper accounts. What a terrible job police did at keeping back sightseers. In the last story in the book we were talking about, the Benny Evangelista crime, the journalists and got there before the police did and walked all through the house, and there's no telling how many clues they destroyed.
Of course, in those days, forensic evidence wasn't as good as it is today. I mean, you weren't going to get DNA evidence.
That's very
although
true.
Although I think they did have fingerprinting at that point.
By that point, they had fingerprinting, they had blood typing, they had hair analysis, so they could do some things.
Or at least find the murder weapon. Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes they could find one if it had been left behind.
But in cases like the Axeman in New Orleans, he pretty much grabbed whatever axe was there, I thought. Some of the axes or the murder weapons were actually left at the crime scene.
Yeah, he usually did, which today they would call that his signature. It was his way of taking, quote-unquote, credit for the crime. But it appears he didn't bring any axes with him. He would just, almost every family had an axe back then to cut up firewood and that sort of thing, and he would just take whatever axe was handy and use it. Which was rather clever because there was no way to trace anything back to him.
You know, no shop owner selling people things. Yeah. Who would remember it?
Yep.
Wow.
Well, we're down to about 7 minutes.
You have to come back.
You had one up. Yeah.
I'd love to.
We got one other one here. Before we jump off, it was called Jean Paul Dutch Ovens, His Wife.
How's that for a pun?
Yeah.
If you don't know what it means, Google it.
The
reason I was able to get away with that was that he actually did cremate his wife's remains in a Dutch oven.
Yep.
And I said to myself, I'm never going to get a chance to use a pun like that again. I better use it.
Well, he killed quite a few people, though.
At least 6, it appears.
Yeah, and before they actually found evidence and was able to pin the murders on him. So.
Yeah, he went to jail for a little bit, and then he just simply walked away, and they never found him.
They never found him. Yeah, so he killed 6, walked away, and
maybe a lot more than 6.
Yeah, it was murder and escape. How did he just walk away? I mean, I remember what the story said. He was already in prison or in jail. And I guess he was outside and asked the guard if he could, you know, take a stroll outside the gate and walked away.
Exactly
and,
what happened.
And
it's one of those things that's really dark, and yet at the same time, it's just really kind of funny that they actually let this man accused of 6 murders go for a stroll outside the prison gate.
And they didn't want to tell the public for the way he walked off.
Because it was embarrassing.
Yeah.
So they waited about 3 days, and then they finally told the public, this guy who killed possibly 6 people, he's on the loose.
Yeah. And they never did find him.
No, I did some research. I tried to find more about him. He probably changed his name and moved away somewhere, and there's no telling.
Interesting, though. Great book.
Do not Google that.
No. Do not you may be better off not knowing what it means. I couldn't help myself. Life rarely gives you a chance like that.
All right.
Yeah,
we
have
people
in the chat room saying it's not 2 hours. Certainly not 2 hours. This went by way too fast.
Well, I'll be glad to come back. I've had a great time.
Well, we appreciate that. That's what we like to do is just have a good time and fun people enjoy it. 2 hours goes by real quick on our show. It does not seem like it's been 2 hours.
I know. Isn't that surprising?
Well, especially when stories are this good and the topic is amazing. I have to say, I've never thoroughly enjoyed a book more than reading horror.
Wow. Thank you. That's a wonderful compliment. Thank you so much.
So when does your new book come out?
Should be in September.
And
it's scheduled for September.
Is that the creepy California one?
That one's already out. Yeah, the New England book, Northern State book, should be out in September, and maybe possibly the Western book. That one needs just a little more material, so I'm not positive. If it doesn't come out this year, it should be out next year. And I hope the Kentucky book is out next year.
Well, there's two books we want to get you back for then, Creepy California and Louisville Murder and Mayhem.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, that's actually one of my favorites of mine. I think that one's pretty good.
Yeah. I'll stay in contact with you and we'll set something up toward May, June, something like that.
Okay.
And go from there. Then we'll get you back in the fall when the other one comes out.
Great. I'd love to. Thank you.
We like to have good guests come back.
I certainly do appreciate it.
We had a good time. The people in the chat room thoroughly enjoyed it.
Great. I hope I hear from them.
Okay. Tina said she wants to know the name of your book again. It is called Horror in the Heartland. So
if you happen to live in Indiana, I've got 2 or 3 other books about Indiana that are already out, have been out for a few years.
And those are called?
One is called, isn't that, I can never remember the name of it. Strange Tales of Crime and Murder from Southern Indiana is one of them. One of them is Forgotten Tales of Indiana. Yeah, I think it's actually one of my best ones. And then there's, you mentioned Murder and Mayhem in Louisville. There's also a Murder and Mayhem in Indiana.
Yeah. So with that, we're down to 2 minutes. So if you want to tell everybody where your websites are, how they can follow you on Facebook, and how they can get your books, feel free to go right ahead and do that.
Okay. Well, I'm actually, I have two pages on Facebook. One is Keven D. McQueen, which is just weird comedy. And the other is Keven McQueen, which is the author site. My website, which mentioned before, was kevenmcqueenstories.com. But remember, my name is spelled K-E-V-E-N. And my books have come out from a variety of publishers, but most of them are from Arcadia History Press, Pelican Publishing, and Indiana University Press.
And they are available on Amazon.
Yes, one came from Jesse Stewart Foundation, and my three earliest ones came from McClanahan Publishing. Awesome. Yeah. But if you look, you can certainly find them. They're all in print, I believe.
Yes. And like I said, his website is hysterically funny.
Thank you.
Especially, like I said, the infrequent facts. Awesome.
Oh, I'll have to go reread that one. It's been so long, I don't even remember what I said at it.
All right, we're fixing to jump off. We want you to stay on for a few minutes after we're off, and we'll chat with you for a minute.
Okay, I'd love to.
With that, next week we have with us Herman Stevenson. I know I got some EVPs from him. We'll be talking with him. He does real great work with electronics. So with that, we'll see you next week at the same time. This is Henry Foister.
And Barbara Duncan.
And we will see you next week. So good night, everybody.
You've been listening to The Paranormal View on the ParaX Radio Network. Join us again next week at the same time for more of The Paranormal View.